They're called the Beyonders. They are dreamers, destroyers. All of reality is their whim. Who dares stand before them? Only doom. The multiverse is dying. Only two universes remain. Today, Earths collide. In the Ultimate Universe, Nick Fury contacts the Ultimate Reed Richards, also known as the Maker. The final incursion is here, and the Ultimate Universe is ready. They aren't going to risk death, so SHIELD is preparing a preemptive strike on the Marvel Universe. They're going to send everything. Everything they've got. On the other side of the incursion, the 616 universe is also getting ready for a fight. SHIELD and an army of heroes are gathered together, and a battle begins. New York City is attacked, but don't worry, Spider-Man's got this. Maybe? Meanwhile, in the Baxter building, a lifeboat is being prepared. If this is indeed the end times, then the 616 Reed Richards will at least be able to preserve the human race. Black Widow is gathering the world's most able minds and important people in the hopes that humanity will survive all of this. Outside, a battle rages on. The heroes struggle against the ultimate forces until two sentinels arrive. All this time, the X-Men have been well aware of the problem regarding incursions, but until now, Cyclops has largely been sitting on the sidelines. But Scott has been preparing his own solution to the problem, and the X-Men join the Avengers in defending their world. A team of the two factions travel to the Ultimate Earth, where they attack the Triskelion, this version of the SHIELD's headquarters. Together, they are able to topple the building. But now it is the Maker's turn to enter the fray. He unleashes a fleet of highly advanced weapons as they make a devastating attack on Earth 616. From a safe location, a team of villains look on. With little else to do, Wilson Fisk is hosting a party where they shall drink with joy at their hero's greatest failure. Until they hear a voice. Gentlemen, they say that when you die, you can't take it with you. Which begs the question, exactly what am I going to do with all these bullets? In the city's streets, Black Widow's ship, escorting a team destined to save the human race, is tragically destroyed in an instant. It's time. There's little else to do. Black Panther and Reed activate a device which is connected to the teleporting hero known as the Manifold. The heroes that are to be saved are teleported to the life raft. Many are brought on board, including Spider-Man, Star-Lord, and Captain Marvel, while others, like the rest of the Guardians of the Galaxy, are left behind. There is no space. There is no time. The Sentinels are struggling to hold off the ultimate forces. Cyclops decides it's time to activate his master plan. The Phoenix Egg is ready to hatch. There you are, old friend. Remember me? Remember how this feels? It's love. The life raft sets off, while the Phoenix rampages outside, until Scott Summers suddenly finds himself aboard the raft with the others. The heroes settle in as they take off, but as they do, the incursion is closing in on the raft, and a bolt of lightning causes a massive hull breach on the vessel. A chunk of the ship is blown off, and inside are a number of heroes, including the rest of the Fantastic Four. Reed and T'Challa prepare to rescue them, but it's too late. The Invisible Woman is unable to sustain a shield around the debris, and everyone on board rapidly dissolves into nothing. Reed is devastated, but the heroes have no time for grief. They rush to escape the incursion, and as worlds collide, everything dissolves into a bright white light. My entire life, I believed in better days ahead. I believed in tomorrow. I hid that belief in my heart, a stronghold against a world that devours hope. But now the walls have fallen, I have been overrun, and I hope, I believe, in nothing.
In the beginning, there was nothing, followed by everything, swirling, burning, specks of creation that circled life-giving suns. God Doom created the light. Then there was Earth. The firmament cooled, and he raised up a land, this holy land, the world, and upon it, he set his kingdoms. In the kingdom of Utopolis, a small ragtag band are investigating seismic activity in the area, but instead have found the remains of a strange vessel that is not from this world. They plan to dig it out for further study. Doomguard, today. Many will try, but one will be chosen to wield the hammer of gods. He has been chosen. But before he can begin his lessons, he, along with his brothers and sisters, must honor their god of doom. The young one is told that his order is to police the kingdoms of their god. The order has jurisdiction over all. One baron has fallen out of the grace of their god, and they are now tasked to bring him in for trial. The new wielder of the hammer now travels with the elder one to the kingdom of Bar Sinister, who is ruled by its baron. Entering the throne room, the elder, with conviction, orders Baron Sinister to stand trial for his crime of discord. But Sinister is unmoved and plays it coy. He asks if he even has the right guy, but they came with orders from the Maker, and Baron Sinister reluctantly hands himself over. Doomstud, where a world-eating sentinel stands guard over Castle Doom, where the High Court convenes, and where God Doom himself sits in judgment on his throne, Yggdrasil, the World Tree. Baron Sinister, finding a way to be released with a clean slate and in accordance with the laws of Doom, challenges a fellow Baron to trial by combat. Jamie Braddock stands ready, but it is not he who Sinister wants, but instead, the younger brother Brian has been chosen. The battle commences and Brian takes the first strike to decapitate the Sinister One. Brian believes himself the victor, but any battle against Baron Sinister is not so easily won. Sinister's body rolls up and knocks Brian to the ground. He reclaims his head and strikes a death blow to Brian, but suddenly, his weapon is neutralized by their maker. Doom orders everyone to their knees. King Doom cares not for the bickering of barons, but instead, he brings news of heretics, rebels, non-believers residing in Baron Braddock's kingdom of Higher Avalon. Once brought forth and tortured for information, these rebels manage only one name, Braddock. King Doom demands to know the location of the hidden citadel that houses these heretics from Brian. But the young Braddock doesn't know, in which case Doom finds Brian guilty for the sins of the people of Higher Avalon. But the truth comes out, Jamie Braddock has claimed knowledge of the rebels and pleads for mercy for his brother. Jamie is taken away for his crimes against their maker, and Brian is elected as the new Baron succeeding his brother. Moments later, while conversing with Sheriff Strange, Valeria brings forth newfound information about a crashed site. The material on the ship does not match anything that they have available, but is still in the realm of possibility. Her interest is put to an end by the Sheriff, who says that this is schism. Sheriff Strange orders Valeria's researchers to abandon the site. It is now quarantined. Elsewhere, on top of the wall known as the Shield, Jamie Braddock is sentenced, but before his sentencing is passed, the Elder Thor presents him with armor and weapon. He takes on his sentencing with honor and leaps forth. His sentencing awaits. 250 feet later, Jamie finds himself in the Deadlands. His battle for survival begins as a venom creature stands ready to consume his flesh, but Jamie is a warrior and he will not go down so easily. But how will he fare against an army of abomination? Or the seasonal migration of the drone army that is the Annihilation Wave? Both of which pales in comparison to the damned Ultron AI, self-replicating super-evolving automatons that systematically try to break containment every generation. Hours later, young Thor and the Elder reports back to Sheriff Strange. The deed is done and Jamie Braddock is sentenced. But their task is not done yet. They now head off to secure and quarantine the crash site. Arriving on location, the Thors watch as a researcher stands in amazement. He falls to his curiosity and lays hands on the vessel. A loud gush of wind erupts from the ship and the hull is opened. The Thors rush towards the researcher, but a spear launches out of the hull and straight into the elder's abdomen. He yells at the young one to return to the sheriff and inform him that they have found death. The Elder readies his hammer as lightning pours out of it, but he is not fast enough as more objects are thrown into his flesh. Who is it that dares defy the Maker's justice? It is the Cabal, a and they have arrived at a very strange place. Thanos grabs a researcher and demands to know where they are. He demands for a name. Trembling in front of the Mad Titan, the researcher states, "This place? The Highborn calls it Latverion. Believers calls it God's Kingdom. But everyone else, we common folk, we call it something else. We call it..."
Castle Doom. Sheriff Strange is giving his weekly report to the God King. No major incident has occurred from the Shield in the last week. There have been a few minor skirmishes in the kingdoms. Inferno smolders as usual. The Green North rages, and there are scattered reports of a traveler illegally crossing mutant borders. While Strange discusses the building tension between Higher Avalon and Baron Sinister, Doom interrupts him. The king wants to know why Steven even bothers with this trivial nonsense. Strange insists that Doom is all-powerful, but not all-knowing. This is the last world, and they can't risk anything happening to it. But Doom remains unconcerned. Steven is frustrated and reveals that he remembers the world like it once was, and not just how it is now. Doctor Strange remembers everything, and how he could have been God instead of Doom. Victor reminds Steven that he refused this job and Doom had to take it, but Strange says it all just serves to remind him of the importance of their task. If Battleworld falls, all of reality goes with it, so Strange plays close attention to the unknown, for the unknown is their greatest threat. Doom simply restates that he is not worried about this and has full and complete faith in his sheriff. Strange thanks Victor for his kind words and the faith his friend bestows in him. As they move on to other matters, the sheriff suddenly gets a call about some foreboding news from Doomguard. Later, in the kingdom of Utopolis, Strange arrives to investigate the Cabal's crash site. They come across a dead Thor and spot the Cabal's tracks leaving the area. The sheriff sends the Thors to track the fugitives down, while he opens the vessel. The magician detects a presence inside the ship and demands that it reveal itself. Miles Morales, alive and well, emerges from the ship. Miles explains how he sneaked aboard during the final incursion, but Strange stops him quickly, shocked to learn that Miles remembers the world as it once was. Back at Castle Doom, Victor comes across Sue Storm, who is watching over her children as they are playing with the castle's Galactus. The two discuss things. Doom tries to reprimand her for leaving the castle without protection earlier, but Sue chastises Victor for forgetting that the woman can turn herself invisible and defend herself if needed. Doom apologizes, and the two turn their attention to Johnny Storm. This world's Human Torch was unhappy with Doom ruling Battleworld and tried to foment dissent. Victor left his punishment with Sue, who decided that rather than have him sent beyond the Shield, it would do her brother more honor to become Battleworld's son. High above, Johnny now burns in orbit around Battleworld, providing light and heat for the sole planet in existence. This leaves the man in agony, but at least it is a place of honor, and now the people worship him. Doom then comments how he has changed himself, and in spite of Susan's encouragement, Victor states that he feels like a poor god. Doom admits he is still flawed and can't even heal his own face. But Susan encourages Doom, saying that she chose him not because of his looks, but for his mind and his heart. She has Victor take off his mask so that all may see what she sees, a god with great love for his people. We next go to the hidden island of Agamotto, to Strange's Sanctum Sanctorum. This is a safe haven from a world of prying eyes, and to remember all that has been lost. Strange takes a young version of Thor and Miles to a new vessel, similar to the one Miles came to Battleworld in. The young Thor opens this craft, and from it, the surviving 616 heroes emerge. Miles and Peter are utterly shocked, but glad to see one another, while Carol Danvers asks what is going on. Doctor Strange has trouble at first confirming these really are the same 616 heroes that he once knew, until Cyclops emerges from the vessel, still powered by the Phoenix. Next, Black Panther and Reed Richards emerge, but Mr. Fantastic is still devastated from the loss of his family. Doctor Strange warns the heroes that the situation is very complicated right now, and quite different from the world they left. The heroes have been in stasis for 8 years. Everything died, but in that moment of death, Doom created a new world, built from the remnants of collapsed worlds and cobbled together into one remaining planet. Battleworld has been all that existed during this time. Steven reveals that he found the 616 heroes 3 years ago, but left them in stasis. He says that he needed to consider things and didn't know quite what was going to be on board. Outraged, Reed demands a better explanation, but Doctor Strange only says that Doom has been very, very good at playing God. Back in the Kingdom of Utopolis, the Cabal discuss their new surroundings. Maximus is fascinated by this place, as the sun appears to orbit the planet, not the other way around. The others are frustrated and insist they should have questioned the Thor at the crash site, but as Thanos looks up, he is certain they don't need to go anywhere for answers. The Thors are here.
On the hidden island of Agamotto, the remaining heroes of the two Earths are educated on the ways of this new world by Sheriff Strange. He tells them that their assumptions were correct, that there was something or someone behind the incursions. Unfortunately, no one could stop the perfect annihilation plans that the Beyonders had put in motion. Even Doctor Strange turned and ran when he looked into the dark abyss that was the Omnipotence. Doom did not. Doom saved all that was left to save, and they killed their foe and took their powers for themselves. Doubt him if you want. Defy him. Curse his very existence. It matters not. Doom reigns supreme. Long may he wear his crown. Cyclops, with the entire powers of the Phoenix Force, stands ready to challenge Doom's reign, but Strange objects. Then suddenly, a hammer of a Thor begins to glow. Strange now sees that their attention is needed elsewhere. The Kingdom of Utopolis. A battle rages on as the Thor Corps takes on the Cabal. Two Thors are heavily wounded, and the Corps knows that they are losing. A Thor, using his hammer, signals the alarm for help, but this unnatural melee requires more than their army of Thors. This requires the attention of Doom himself. The Thor strikes with lightning, and one Thor vanishes from the fight, only to reappear in front of Doom himself. He informs his god and creator that they are losing to unknown heretics that would threaten Doom's reign. But the All-Father does not take this information lightly. He marches towards the chamber of the All-Seeing. From here, Doom can watch his world in the comfort of his own home. The chaotic battle displays right in front of him, Thor versus Cabal. But when Valeria asks her father what he sees, God Doom says that he sees mortals fighting mortals. Gnats that do not concern him, but Valeria points out the fact that the multiple versions of this heretic are known to the court, but none of them shows the fearful amount of power that this one displays. Even Susan Storm points out that her force field cannot withstand more than a few blows from Amelnira, but these rebels are standing strong as their fields repel the weapon of the gods. As the court watches the battle unfold, a portal opens up which causes the Cabal and the Thors to halt their battle for a brief moment. Sheriff Strange has arrived with company. The heroes engage the Cabal, and still, the court watches on. Valeria has researched these familiar heroes many times before, as she has concluded that the analogs all share something familiar and constant, but these fighters are somehow different. At this time, even Doom notices something familiar about these heroes, but then one person catches the All-Father's eye. Doom has spent some time scouring each kingdom looking for a version of this man, but to no avail. Reed Richards doesn't exist in any of the kingdoms, but here he is. In a flash of light, Doom appears in the epicenter of chaos. Everybody stands in awe as a new player enters the battlefield. Doom has arrived, and he has words for his old foe. Richards, he screams. Mr. Fantastic berates his old enemy and what he did, but Doom will not be scolded by anyone. He saved the unsavable in the face of total annihilation. Their conversation gets interrupted by another alpha dog. Thanos approaches and accuses Doom of being a false god. If one plays at being a god, one would not shy away from saying it. Doom only has one reply. I am God. Doom attacks with his fury and the ground opens up to swallow anything in his path. After showing his might, he informs his old rivals that he is God in this new world, and God is merciful. Readjust your old way of thinking, then you will bend your knee and bow your head at my feet, he states. But an overwhelming heat force shakes him to the bones. All he can do is defend while a voice states, I do not need your mercy. Things change, they evolve. The future cannot be denied. Cyclops, with the fury of the Phoenix, stands tall. In the end, you are just a man. I am a mutant. I am the future in the present. And all worlds, even yours, belong to us. This world is my... Before Summers could finish his sentence, Doom grabs the X-Men by the neck, and in his hands, he snaps it. Cyclops' lifeless body falls to the floor, but only one man stands in the audience. During the battle between God and the Phoenix Force, Sheriff Strange has sent the Cabal and the surviving heroes to the wind. He knows that none of them will bend the knee, which is a death sentence. Strange will not be a part of that. Some of those heroes, Strange has spent a lifetime with. Some he calls friend. Doom demands for the heroes to be sent back, but Strange stands firm on his decision. You will not test me, Doom states. But Strange now sees something he never saw before. He now sees that Doom is still scared of his old foe, Reed Richards. Even with all of his mighty powers, Doom is still scared. He states, well, you know what, old friend? I think you should be. The Allfather Doom will not stand any form of insubordination, not even from his second in command, from a man he called friend.
Before the world, there was the ether. We cannot call it heaven, or forever, or any other joyful thing, for it was nothing. And in this ocean of absence, there was only God Doom and his first disciple, our fallen leader, Stephen Strange. Think on it, brothers and sisters. There was nothing. And then there was everything. And the only witness to the miracle of creation, besides the All-Father himself, was the good Sheriff Strange. What an honor! What a life! If Valhalla is for the brave, Stephen, then you will be their king. Of all of us, you are truly the most worthy. At the funeral, Susan tells Doom that memorials will be held for Stephen all over Battleworld. But the good sheriff was Victor's friend, and they thought he would appreciate a more personal affair. Doom thanks Susan, while Franklin Richards flies up to the statue of Stephen. He says that he is sorry that Strange died, as he liked the man a great deal, and vows that when he finds out who did this, he's going to smash them into little pieces. While Susan is surprised at these words, Doom looks on in silence. Hours later, he still stands watch until Valeria interrupts him. She offers condolences to her father, and Doom says we all deserve a better fate than death. Valeria then asks something that is bothering her, as she is confused as to how people escape the judgment of God. Doom explains that he is emotional right now, and that if he acts, his unspeakable power could break Battleworld. But Valeria is still unsatisfied. She needs to know more, asking just what happened out there that could have left Stephen dead and Doom so placid. Her father pauses before saying that undying love for family and eternal patience are not the same thing, warning his daughter not to confuse them. He asks if she can find those who escaped from the incident without asking more questions, and she affirms that she can. As she leaves to follow God's orders, Doom looks on at Stephen once more, before cursing his name. He opens a portal and walks into an empty void. He comes before Owen Reese, the Molecule Man. This strange one-time villain is hungry. Every molecule in his body starves for more, even after feasting on all of reality. But Doom didn't bring food, as he has other things on his mind. He tells Owen that Stephen Strange is dead, which surprises his old friend. Reed guesses it was cancer, as it's always cancer. But Doom clarifies that Stephen fell to a different sort of decay. It was doubt that killed the good sheriff. Owen finds this interesting, as Strange knew. He was there when everything died. He saw it for himself. But Doom corrects him. He was there at the end, but even Victor wasn't there for the beginning. At first, it was just Owen. and the Beyonders. The Molecule Man states that's not true. It all began with the Beyonders alone. They built whole universes, random ideas to be tested and given form. They pushed life as far as it could go, and then they got bored. They took an interest in the idea of death, and thus created the Molecule Man, a living sentient bomb, one man, split and seeded all over reality to kill the multiverse. But the Beyonders forgot that every man has a choice, and Owen chose doom. Together they formed the Order of the Black Swans and began killing Molecule Man across the universe, until the incursions began. So the two men came up with a new plan, a new bomb, a better Owen Reese. With Stephen Strange joining them, they stood before the Beyonders. They stole their powers and kept it somewhere safe, and used it to preserve what little remained of the multiverse. But it was too much for Stephen, who couldn't handle choosing what lives and what dies. He passed the responsibility over to Doom, and that was the day he became a god. And now Stephen is dead, which Doom admits was his own doing. But Owen already knows this. He could smell the guilt all over Victor. Owen thinks that everything is about to unravel. As Doom leaves, Reese wonders who will die next, knowing that if Doom goes, Battleworld dies with him. But if Owen dies? Well, wouldn't that be exciting? Elsewhere, Valeria has gathered together the Future Foundation's Justice Division. Their members are Nostradamus, Alex Powers, Dragon Man, Bentley 23, Night Machine, and Psycho Man. She tells her team that God has a job for them, and that their first and only priority is to find the team that has escaped into Battleworld. She orders all other projects to be suspended. There will be no more deep diving into the negative zone that exists deep within Battleworld. No more cataloging objects of great power. And, in spite of his protest, Bentley is specifically ordered to suspend all his little experiments south of the shield. Using specialized equipment, the team goes over what little they know. They were able to find the scene of the crime, using spikes in the relative energy levels of Battleworld. Stephen Strange was always different from the rest of the energy that exists on this planet. While all beings of this world give off similar energy to that of Dr. Doom, Stephen always registered on the negative side, as an absence of Doom. This negative energy spiked before his death, implying that it was Stephen who scattered the fugitives away from Doom. What this could mean worries the Future Foundation, who think this involves something much more sinister than simple mind control or coercion. So Valeria gives them her orders. They're going to take this all the way to the end of the line, no matter where it goes. She'll handle any noise from the throne, but for now, what they learn stays with them. Valeria wants to know what really happened, who these people are, where they disappeared to. She wants to know what they're capable of, and more than anything else, they have to find out what these fugitives want, and why it scares God so badly.
Castle Doom, it has been 3 weeks since the death of our beloved Sheriff Stephen Strange. God himself meets with his chief science officer, aka his daughter, Valeria. The daughter did her best, but she is nowhere closer to finding the rebels that are accused of murdering God Doom's hand. Even the bodies of Corvus Glaive and Proxima Midnight, brought to them by Baron Apocalypse, still does not yield any answers. The Black Swan joins their meeting and corrects the daughter of God. These two are husband and wife, she states. They are the surviving members of the Black Order, the generals of the tyrant, Thanos. Through the Swan's memory, we discover that after the great battle, everyone was scattered, but the Black Swan made her way to Castle Doom, and now she feels at home. Hours later, in the Foundation, Valeria contacts her team. She informs them that something isn't right. She feels like she is being lied to. The subject changes as Alex informs her of a breakthrough. They finally found the source of God Doom's power, and Valeria is standing on it. The news does not end there as her team continues to inform her on more strange drones found in their land. 6 more. Further studies suggest that these drones are looking for something. Valeria can't help herself but wonder, who is building these things? Somewhere inside Battleworld, The drones have come home to their maker, Reed Richards, one from the 616 reality and the other from the Ultimate Universe. These drones have been instrumental in collecting data. They now have a better understanding of this strange world and the full capabilities of Victor Von Doom, who now calls himself a god. The Maker has set loose one of his projects, who he calls the Prophet. This man has gathered non-believers that grew into an army, a legion of Doom deniers who now marches towards his throne and the World Tree. The Maker seeks a plan to kill their foe, but Reed is not ready to consider that yet. Our problem, as I see it, is determining how Victor Von Doom came to possess such power. Reed Richards, our hero from the 616, has a plan and he already got his best people working on it. Castle Doom, Miles Morales, and Peter Parker arrives at the spot indicated to them by a device created by Reed Richards. They found the exact spot, but nothing is here, except the statue. It could be underground. Actually, there's a trapdoor. Valeria pops out behind the shadows. I found it earlier. You're looking for the source too, aren't you? Parker is shocked, but no spider sense. They are not in danger. He knows this kid, but things are different here, and Valeria has no clue as to who he is. When asked if she is coming with them, she tells the two spider heroes that she spent the last hour thinking about it, but she can't. At the end of the day, Valeria is just a kid, and if she discovers that her father isn't who he says he is, then, well, that's just too much for a kid to comprehend. Valeria allows them to pass, but they must answer one question to keep her silence. Did you or anyone on your team kill Stephen Strange? Parker replies, no. Of course not. Inside, the heroes found a blinding white room and a man Parker identifies as Owen Reese, the Molecule Man. Reese has information to share, but he is hungry. Unfortunately, Parker doesn't have any food, but wait, Morales does. He brings out a hamburger from his pocket. The sight of a burger causes Reese to salivate. He must have that burger. Parker questions Morales as to how he obtained the burger. Morales states that he got that from home, his home, before the incursion. So that's an 8-year and 3-week-old burger? I don't think suspended animation counts. Oh man, I don't think he should be eating that.
So good.
After he devoured the burger, Reese is presented with a question. Where can they find the source of Doom's power? Reese states,
oh yes, you're looking at him.
Castle Doom. Meeting after meeting, God Doom grows weary. He now meets with some of his barons. They bring news of a man who caused uprisings throughout battle world known as the Prophet. This man raised an army large enough that entire kingdoms are bending to his will. Apocalypse shares his counsel.
Only the strong shall survive. Power structures must be maintained. God Doom is among us. Anyone who say otherwise is an offense. Only the loyal shall live. Kill the rest.
Doom agrees with his counsel, but instead of sending in his private police force of Thors, God Doom demands that you, his loyal barons, shall tend to this pretender and his mob, for Doom is losing what little grace he still possesses. The meeting adjourns, and Baron Sinister returns to speaking to one of the heroes from the 616. Captain Marvel is his guest, and the two of them will build an alliance to usurp Doom's throne. The hidden island of Agamotto, T'Challa, and Namor finally arrive at their destination. They brave through the World Sea, the Great Leviathan Horde, and the hidden isle itself to be able to reach Stephen Strange's sanctuary. With the Eye of Agamotto, they gain access through. Suddenly, the face of Stephen Strange appears, but it's only a sentry. It prepares the death traps to test the ex-kings of Atlantis and Wakanda for being friends or foe. They pass a set of tests, so the sentry offers them two of the most valuable artifacts owned by Stephen Strange. The first one is a Siege Courageous. This object of power can transport them to anywhere they wish to go. The second item is Stephen's most precious possession, an item that might be the only thing on this world that can smite a god. Stephen Strange presents an Infinity Gauntlet. Elsewhere, a young Franklin is tucked into bed by his mother, Susan. He requests for a bedtime story. His favorite story. A story of the Fantastic Four. Susan recalls a time when there were four of them. Her brother, Johnny Storm, their friend, Ben Grimm, her father, Dr. Franklin Storm, and herself. They set on what they thought was going to be an incredible journey, but their ship crashed and they emerged with incredible power. They protected the Earth, but one day, their world ended and this new world began. It was a cruel and dark world. War plagued every corner, but there was hope. a brilliant and blinding light. It was Franklin's father, Victor Von Doom. He made a world from nothing, and he made a world that is everything. Dr. Franklin Storm died before the light's arrival, but Johnny Storm became the sun, which brought light onto this wonderful world. And Ben, well, Ben Grimm is a story for another day, for when you are older. The story ends and the mother kisses her son goodnight. Elsewhere on the shield, detention level, the thing, Ben Grimm, chats with their prisoner, a man found on the wall who calls himself Thanos. The Mad Titan informs Grimm that this world is not what it should be, and that Ben Grimm's service to God Doom is a sham. Where he came from, Grimm is the closest friend of Doom's greatest enemy. Ben has shamed him time and time again. Doom is a petty usurper of powers far grander than himself. Doom convinced Johnny Storm to be the sun, and Ben Grimm to be on the wall. Not for service to the people Doom watches over, but because God fears him.
Doom convinced you to live on your knees. He has beaten you as you lay there.
The Titan states.
Are you just going to die here, or are you going to stand up?
With those words, Ben Grimm, the thing, obliterates the shield, the wall that separates the horrors and nightmares away from Doom's land. Ben Grimm made a decision. He will stand.
The Prophet appeared from nothing, emerging from the great waste, a cause fully formed, an idea given shape, that Doom is no god. The Prophet spoke of liberty and freedom. It sparked a fire. Monuments were toppled, and the people raised their arms. They marched on Castle Doom to cast out God himself. But who was this great catalyst? His name was Maximus. He led these people to certain doom. And at the end, things are going to be so much fun. As Doom watches over the battle's castle, Black Swan suggests that she join the fray. Victor refuses this offer, as he fears she will lose herself to her anger, much like how Doom would lose control if he fought against the rebels. Sue Storm asks Victor not to take things personally, as this is what free people do when confronted by authority. She's confident this will end no differently than it has before, but Valeria disagrees. This is different. Something more is going on here. Victor agrees with his daughter and summons the Thors. In the battlefield, Maximus cheers on his charges, but is soon overwhelmed by Madeline Pryor's goblin army. This is observed by Mr. Sinister and Captain Marvel, who decide it is time to act. They turn on the goblins, and while they are able to beat Madeline down, Sinister suddenly finds himself decapitated by Holocaust, son of Apocalypse. Doomguard, Citadel of the Thors, then appears above the battlefield, but the Thors have broken out into civil war over the words of Jane Foster. Lady Thor calls upon some select members to strike out against Doom, and they charge, devastating Apocalypse's army. Victor watches this and realizes he has been betrayed again. Apocalypse fights these traitors, frustrated over all of this. If he must bow down over Doom, then the traitors can be given no quarter. However, this is not the last betrayal of the day. A helicarrier appears in the sky, with the Maestro attacking. He orders an army of Hulks to go and break the world. Meanwhile, Reed Richards, the Maker, and Star-Lord are preparing their end of the plan. While Maximus has created a distraction, they will sneak by Doom undetected to steal the most valuable thing in the multiverse. The Maker says that Maximus will not last long against Doom, and it's time for them to unleash their secret plans. Reed contacts T'Challa and tells him to begin his attack. With Namor beside him, the Black Panther creates a hole in the wall, unleashing the Marvel zombies. The undead are confused. Their skin itches, and they feel compelled to kneel before T'Challa. It turns out the mantle of the King of the Dead isn't just a name, and Black Panther is able to order them to march. Reluctantly, the zombies vow to seek glory and honor, and they prepare to strike.
Doomguard, the battle rages on between Doom's forces and the insurgents. Peter Quill, Reed Richards, and his doppelganger from the parallel Earth are on their way to join the fight, but a Hulk appears out of nowhere and takes out the engines. Elsewhere on the battlefield, the Maestro and his army of Hulks have laid waste to Doom's front lawn. The Maestro looks upon Doom's throne and is ready to take it for himself, but Ben Grimm, the Thing, appears behind the Future Hulk. Grimm is on his way towards Doomguard to settle old scores. It appears that something was in his way. Explosions echo throughout Doom's land, but the loud burst caught the attention of the Black Swan. The rebels have reached the castle. Doom commands his loyal Swan to take care of it. He now returns his focus towards the battlefront. Terax, the servant of the World Eater, finally found his master, but this isn't the Galactus he knew and worshipped. This is Doom's watchdog. The watchdog takes his mighty boot and crushes Terax, the Herald of Galactus. He now turns his attention towards a more worthy foe. We discover that Franklin Storm is the Puppet Master and his puppet is the World Eater. Franklin taunts Ben Grimm to challenge his mount. Ben obliges. Susan is distraught. Her friend Ben has left the wall and is in heated combat with her son Franklin. She begs Doom to do something, anything, stop this war, put an end to it. But Doom does not move a muscle. Grimm was the shield, and if the shield has fallen... Far towards the south, an enormous dust cloud heralds the Annihilation Horde, with Thanos the Mad Titan riding into battle. This is it. This is the signal Doom had anticipated. He is now ready to join the war. God is here. God Doom, Franklin's father, is ready and he isn't in a good mood. Franklin harbors the same anger and blasts Ben Grimm in the shoulders. Grimm pauses for a brief second. He now understands that Franklin is Doom's son. That can only mean one thing. Franklin is Susan's kid. Ben lets his guard down. He will not strike the boy. And he tells the son of God to do what he gotta do. Susan is devastated by the destruction of her home and her friend Ben, but her daughter, Valeria, does not share the same feeling. It's some show, Valeria states. The spectacle of it, like theater. The daughter turns towards the mother. Do you love me more than anything, no matter what? Susan says what any mother would say. Yes, of course she does. Then come with me, the daughter states. Elsewhere, Peter Quill is hard at work trying to get his ship to be functional again, but the Black Swan makes her appearance. Quill's idle threat does not sway her as the Black Swan destroys the floor, forcing Star-Lord to plummet towards the floor below. Quill's spleen is broken, and he is probably bleeding internally, but he covets a toothpick he brought from the 616. Quill continues to threaten the Swan, but this time, his pick is the weapon of choice. Fool, the Swan states, you are bleeding on my god throne, little man. Time to die. Say hello to my little friend. Wait for it. Wait for it.
I am Groot.
Valeria and Susan ran from their crumbling home. The world tree just gained sentience and is now walking away. Valeria explains to her mother that they have been lied to. Doom isn't a god. She takes Susan towards the source of God Doom's power, only to find that someone else is already there. Valeria! I guess I shouldn't be so surprised. Hello, Susan. Doom stands between his land and a raging horde of annihilation. Thanos presents himself. The two tyrannical gods stand face to face. Doom begins with offering a large piece of land and appointing Thanos as one of his new barons. But Thanos declines. The Mad Titan was once a god as well, when he wielded the Infinity Gauntlet. Doom is a weak god, a pretender. Doom should bow before Thanos. And do you have an Infinity Gauntlet now? Doom states. God himself reaches deep and pulls out the bones of the Mad Titan. God made a judgment and another foe has been judged. God now turns towards Nihilus. With Thanos gone, Nihilus bends the knee. Doom is owed penance for this indulgence and now, he demands for his renewed servant to turn the Annihilation Wave towards those who would seek to usurp Doom's throne. Elsewhere in the battlefield, the war rages on and bodies are starting to pile, but suddenly a doorway opens up and even God himself is shocked. The zombies have arrived at last with their new leader. Victor! Your reign is over! And it ends with us!
Everything dies. You, me, everyone on this planet. Our sun, our galaxy, and eventually, the universe itself. This is simply how things are. It is inevitable, and I accept it. So this is how it is. All this chaos has been orchestrated by the Black Panther and Namor. Doom is furious, but they don't care, and say goodbye to God. With the power of the Infinity Gauntlet, they turn Victor into glass and shatter him. But it can't be that easy. It won't be. And though it did hurt Doom, he reforms and blasts them with a tremendous wave of energy. T'Challa is able to block the blast with his gauntlet, but Namor is gone. Doom is now giving the Black Panther his full attention. It is time for them to battle as gods. On the earth, in the sky, and the heavens above. In Doom's castle, Sue and Valeria confront the two Reed Richards. Sue only recognizes them through an image of when Reed and his people murdered Doctor Strange. Reed is devastated to hear that she really just knows him through this, and explains this was all Doom's work. Victor is a killer and a fraud, and Reed is here to fix things. As the Panther God clashes with the God of Doom, Reed enters the Molecule Man's realm with the Maker. As the two versions of Reed Richards look on at the source of Doom's power, Reed asks how Owen Reese is doing. The man is still starving, but Reed Richards' ultimate counterpart doesn't care. Using a device he cobbled together, he regresses Reed into the form of an ape. He would be sorry for this betrayal, but he just saw how he almost cried at the sight of Sue Storm. And who would want a weeping god? Owen says he would, and that he's hungry for some pizza. In an instant, the Maker is sliced into pieces and devoured alive. Owen returns Reed to normal and says that Richards needs to pull himself together. He's going to be here soon. Outside, Doom has finally managed to overpower T'Challa. He beats the man down, and Victor declares himself the superior being. But something is wrong. The Black Panther is smiling. All of this chaos was indeed orchestrated, but even T'Challa was a distraction. Doom teleports back to his castle, where he is confronted by Sue. When she asks about Stephen Strange, Doom only says he is sorry, and that he tried. Inside Owen's home, Doom confronts his rival, truly outraged at this madness. He had to meddle, didn't he? They saved millions, while Reed only saved himself. And it's time to die. Doom realizes something is wrong, and Owen says that Doom didn't bring him any food, just like Reed. That makes the two of them equal, doesn't it? So the two men begin a savage fight to the death. Victor is exasperated at all of this. He asks if Reed thinks any of this was easy. He was given impossible choices and did the best he could given these options. But Reed knows better. Victor erased his entire life just to indulge the man's own whims. He stole Reed's family. He closed his hands around everything left in reality and called it his own. And he held it too tight. Victor is astonished at these words and accuses Reed of genuinely believing that he could have done better with all of this power. Reed affirms that he could have, he would have, and they both know it. Doom admits this is true, and Owen says, well, if they both agree. T'Challa activates the Infinity Gauntlet, and everything goes white. He wakes up, home. Astonished that it worked, he looks on as his people are mapping another solar system. He congratulates the men. The West has abandoned their space program, but where they flounder, Wakanda excels. They dare to dream bigger, and their prize is the stars themselves. Owen Reese. The man was so grateful for that burger. Owen said he would repay that boy. Peter Parker greets his companion. He asks if Miles ate a snack and did his homework, and Morales confirms that he has. So Peter says it's time to beat up some bad guys. They swing out into New York City. At the edge of all that is, the Future Foundation is gathered. Owen Reese has a new guide for all his power. With Reed's instructions and Franklin Richards' formidable abilities, they have rebuilt the multiverse, one universe at a time. Each universe is tethered by a version of Molecule Man, and by splitting himself apart, Owen becomes better and more whole. He's healed. But that's just the start of everything. These realms of reality will need to be cataloged and explored. The Future Foundation is ready and willing to do this, together. Sue finds her husband and tells him that this really is something. Franklin asks if they aren't superheroes anymore, and Reed says that for now, they're a family of scientists and explorers. For now, that is good enough. As their son leaves, the couple talks about Ben and Johnny and how they will miss them, but their story isn't over. Those two have more to do back home. Sue looks on at all of reality around them and says that as superheroes, it was a pretty amazing final act to save all that is. Reed says that he learned the difference between living and dying is managing fear, not being so afraid of losing the things you love that you hold them too tight. He used to believe in entropy, that all things must die, but he changed his mind. He's letting go. Because now he believes in expansion. He believes in endurance. You, me, everyone on this planet, our sun, our galaxy, and the universe itself. This is simply how things are. Everything lives. It all started with two men. One was death, and one was life. Hello and welcome to Comic Island. My name is Arden, and this is the complete story of Secret Wars. So this was fun, at least fun enough. Yeah, Secret Wars was great in my opinion, but never showed on problems. The art is well done at times, but relies heavily on the same goofy facial expressions over and over. The series also suffers from a lot of delays, and honestly, it's not like these delays seem to lead to any sense of improved quality either. I think they were just done to get the story done in time, but obviously they didn't have enough time, and the whole thing's a bit of a mess. But you know, there's never quite been a story this big. It started in 2012, then led to a slow, careful build-up towards Marvel literally tearing down the entire multiverse and remodeling things in a new direction. So while it's not perfect, you know what this story reminds me of more than anything? Well, a good time ago, DC did something very similar with the Crisis of Infinite Earths, and I think it's a pretty fair comparison. Both stories were these big, sprawling, epic events, and while neither story is perfect, they added a lot, pushed the continuity towards a new direction, and made for a pretty fun read overall. Now, is Marvel really going in a new direction, or are they just using this as an excuse to roll out new series because comics with the number one tend to sell for more? I mean, they've done it before. They've done it like 3 times in the last 3 years, so it's right to be at least a little suspicious of them. Looking over the all-new, all-different Marvel, it's a little of both. The Fantastic Four are officially defunct because of, well, complicated money and movie rights reissues, and Doctor Doom has a person face now, but most of these changes are superficial. However, I have noticed a more meaningful change going on underneath all of this in Marvel over the last couple of years. Characters are becoming more diverse, women are being better represented while also not dressing in ridiculous outfits, and we seem to be heading in a slow but steady progression towards more original storytelling while avoiding rehashing the same old stuff over and over again. Of course, I say that, but we're also on the cusp of Civil War 2 coming out soon, so whatever. It's hard to tell exactly what's going to happen in the future and whether any of this is really worth it. So I try not to worry about all that reboot stuff or anything like that, and instead just focus on what I have at hand. And on hand is Secret Wars, which is a pretty fun and good story. I recommend it. I had a lot of fun with it, and the premise led to some excellent tie-ins and good storytelling overall. Let me know what you guys think in the comments section below. And don't forget to like, subscribe, and keep reading comics.